Hello and welcome to another D&D Stories. I am your host, TtheWriter. This is the show where I sit here and regale you with all the tabletop gaming stories and remember when something cool happens. We return once more to the land of Oceanrim, all the way underground to the Lost District, where Phudo, Padclaw, the Bullet Slayer, and Alzack, the scholarly scroll scholar, have finally met up in this Avengers Assemble situation that I have been building to for quite some time. And after having worked their way down the massive, mythical lighthouse to street level, they are ready to get out of this building and try to find a way out of the Lost District and back above ground before their food runs out. So they've got the Smiling Man, who has offered them, like, an assassination job, and in exchange will give them a ride in his Spelljammer back to the surface. But they turned him down, and they have to work to find another way out. So, Phudo and Alzack are not stupid. They are both very, very smart players. They're both veteran players as well. So, before they step out on the street level, they eat, they've got their potions and spells ready, what little food they've got, they eat some more. God, we don't have much food left. And then player agency kind of takes over. And player agency, to me, is a nice way of saying they're getting ready to circumvent everything, because I'm not that smart of a DM. By then, again, they're like level 9, level 10. They're very powerful characters, you know, a specialized wizard and, you know, a ranger. So Alzack throws a non-scrying spell on both of them so they can't be spied upon. Then he puts invisibility on both of them so they can't be seen. And of course, if you know your ranger spells, Phudo throws down, pass without a trace, or just without a trace, or something like that, so they can't be tracked. They won't leave behind any kind of smells or footprints or leavings of any sort to anybody could follow them around. So they're invisible, untraceable, and unscryable before they even step out of the head of the door. I was like, gosh, this is going to be a short game. And already I can hear you saying, well, gosh, T, just have monsters that have true sight or something like that, and we'll get to that. But just, I was like, oh, man. As soon as they stepped out the door, untraceable, unscryable, invisible, silent. Gonna be a short game, boys. Gonna be a short game. It's a very smart thing to do, don't get me wrong. I was just like, all right, well, I guess nothing's going to happen. You know, I won't let anything happen to you. Well, then nothing would ever happen to me. Well, makes for an awfully boring story, but whatever. So invisible, untraceable, unscryable. They step out onto street level, and you remember Phudo has dark vision because he's a kobold, and Alzack does not. So Phudo has to kind of lead him by the sleeve, because unless they light up a light source, which is not something you can make invisible, Alzack cannot see. So Phudo kind of leads him around, just like on the sidewalks, sort of, not down the middle of the road, but around the wreckage, around the debris and avalanches of stone and rock from whatever buildings have already fallen apart, around the crates and other things. And they're going to try and make their way towards the docks, or remains of the docks that sank in when the rest of the district sank into the sea and got swallowed up into this air bubble below the surface of the earth. And they find out pretty quickly that it's not so abandoned down here, that there is a very complicated ecosystem, and none of it, almost none of it, is of this world. Because Phudo stops Alzack on a corner when a little group of 5 or 6 flying eyeballs go by. Like, they're the size of eyeballs for you and me, maybe the size of ping pong balls, maybe a little smaller, that are propelled through the air by these little tendrils that come out the back, and they chirp like finches, like little tiny yellow birds, and they fly in like V formations all around where they're going, kind of chirruping and like peering into windows and looking for things and stuff like that. And I say, Phudo, they spot a rat that immediately darts across the street, and they start chirruping and shrieking. And as soon as they do, a huge, like, dinosaur-looking creature bursts out of an alleyway, causing, you know, the two buildings to crash apart from each other. And it leaps upon this tiny little rat and chews it up immediately. And I go, it's basically like a stegosaurus with crow's feet. And instead of like a tiny little head, it's got like an iron helmet, like a pyramid head style. You can't see its eyes or its face or anything. And this long, nasty looking tentacle tongue comes out and just spears this rat through the spine and yanks it back up under the helmet, where you hear its gnashing teeth and and little bits of fur go everywhere. And Fudo's like, oh my god. And I go, it looks your way when you talk. Oh shit. And they wait for a moment, and you know, it searches about, and the eyeballs search about. I was like, it doesn't, you know, you're invisible and untraceable. It doesn't mean you can't speak and make noise. So be careful. And Fudo's like got both of his hands on his muzzle. He's like trying to kind of shuffle Alzack to one side. And I was like, it would be very hard to spot you, but not impossible. So be very careful. And they wait in complete terrified silence for a few moments, because this thing is about the size of a bus. You know, the fact that it was just laying in wait for these flying eyeball monsters to say, hey, here, prey, you know, and then it busts out, and just for something tiny like a rat, you can't imagine how excited it would get if it spotted a kobold and a human being all the way down here. So it's very dangerous down here, and they didn't realize it from all the way up on the tower because they didn't see this thing hiding. And after a while, it kind of wanders off, no doubt to be like a trapdoor spider, almost. Like, it'll hide until prey wanders by, and then it springs out and grabs you at Mach fucking 10. But they decide they're going to give it a wide berth and be careful of all the flying eyeballs and things. And they go over, like, four streets or something. It's a very big area, because remember, Oceanrim is a huge city. So they go over, like, four or five streets, just completely silent. And again, Alzack is basically blind, so Phudo leads him about by, like, the end of his sleeve. And it must have been very, very unnerving, because Phudo had to, like, very quietly, like, mumble all of these things that are happening. And I think at one point, Alzack actually just, like, connected their minds. It's not like not unlike the whisper spell, where you can, like, telepathically talk back and forth. That way they didn't actually have to speak, so they could have normal conversations without making noise. After a while, they just kind of remembered to do that. But Fudo's like doing his very best to think in common, because, you know, if you have like a native language, you think in that native language and then you speak in another language. So he has to very clearly think in common so that Alzack can read his mind and they can, like, magically whisper back and forth without making any noise, which is kind of hard for poor Phudo, but he does his best. It's like giant, you know, little eyeball monsters are like, symbiotic with these giant dinosaur creatures. It's like, it's a good thing you can't see any of this, because I don't think we could take them all. And eventually they come across the apex predator of the Lost District, so to speak. It begins as like a warm breeze at first, and they both kind of stop because there's no air exchange. They're underground, and if there's caverns, they can't possibly reach up through the ocean, or this place would be full of water. So something is forcing the air about. And Phudo stops and he looks like down the street, like five blocks. This is a well-made city, so it's grid-based. And it's a D&D city, so of course it's grid-based. But he looks down like five blocks and there's a mass coming their way. It doesn't touch the ground, but from where he can see, it's nothing but muscles and eyes and teeth and like little flailing tentacles that floats along. But it's not just floating along, it's floating along at like 50 miles an hour, like a fucking semi. and it's about the size of a semi. So Fudo's like, get off the road, get off the road, get off the road. And he shuffles Alzack all the way to one side. And they see as this thing gets closer, it's grabbing up crates and old dumpsters, rocks, anything that just happens to move in front of it, street signs, and just like shoving it in its giant gnashing teeth and maws as its eyes are blinking and looking around wildly. If you want to jump into your bestiary, I think it's the bestiary 5, maybe. It's called a flying polyp, and it's basically like just a classic Lovecraftian monster. It's a blob that can fly at Mach fucking 10 of just tentacles and teeth and eyes and syrupy muscles, and that's about it. But it goes so fucking fast. It's like, again, it's like a semi. It shoots forward at 50 miles an hour, and you'd be goddamned if you stood in front of it, because it would just consume you as soon as fly by without slowing down. So they get off the road as fast as they can and dive into an alleyway and just kind of sit. You know, because it obviously has dark vision, it might have true sight. So they kind of duck behind a bunch of stuff, and it grabs the crate that they are hiding behind, but again, it doesn't slow down. So it crunches up the crate and keeps going. And Alzack kind of puts thumb and forefinger to his chin, and he's like, well, obviously that thing just arrived, like in the past few days, because if that had been here for the past 700 years, it would have eaten everything by now at that speed. So clearly there is a crack or a portal or a formation to the elemental plane of water somewhere in the Lost District, and this thing just showed up, and it's feasting on anything that's not nailed down. So it's got like a stomach like a dragon, and dragons can eat anything and survive, so this flying polyp is patrolling the streets at 50 miles an hour, just at random, and I put it on like the fate chart in case they should run into it again. And the only warning that they get is the breeze that it creates because it's so fucking fast. Anyway, it goes by again and darts off down another street, and then the breeze dies down, the winds die down, and it's quiet again, and it's like, you notice there's no eyeball creatures around, and there's no dinosaur around. That was pretty much like, right now, that's the apex predator of this nightmarish place, and Phudo and Alzack kind of exchange with each other, like, God, it's really crowded down here for an abandoned, you know, lost district. I guess when a crack opened up down here, it became populated with just anything that wandered through. And if there's a docking area, then the water is going out into the ocean. It's not actually filling this place up. So there's just a steady open doorway to Relea somewhere down here, and it's flooding it with monsters. Holy crap. I mean, ugh, it's awful. But eventually they pass by like a temple to like a nautical god. Just say Poseidon. I don't know. I didn't make a name for it because we didn't have any religious characters at the time. So the gods were not really closely watching over Oceanrim, which may have been part of the problem, but you never know. They come across a shrine or a small church to a nautical god that has a poor box in front of it. And a poor box is where, if you're walking by, you can like drop a gold piece in, and then at the end of the day, they collect the money and it goes to the local soup kitchen or whatever happens. Alzack decides he wants to open the poor box, and there's nothing in it. But at the same time, he's starting to witness greater forces. So he reaches into his bag and he drops 2 gold pieces, plink plunk, into this ancient poor box, and the metallic sound, under guise of complete silence, attracts the flying eyeballs that fly around in V formation, and they look around, and Alzack kind of backs off and leans against a wall. Still invisible, still untraceable, but he made noise, so it attracted a bunch of them. And they fly around, and they look in the poor box, and they look in the windows and around the corners and stuff, and they start chirruping back and forth to each other, but as again, they can't see him. They don't have true sight. And they're kind of confused, so they kind of mill about for a while like so many gnats. There's like 10 or 15 of them just in a little cloud, just wandering around where Alzack was. And Phudo kind of like pulls him to one side. What the fuck are you doing? It's fucking dangerous down here. Come on. And eventually something worse pops up because I have to roll on the fate chart because I've developed kind of this weird ecosystem down here. And I roll on the fate chart to see if anything else shows up or if they can get away or whatever happens. And a giant bird-like eyeball shows up. It's like the size of a beach ball, and it's covered with veins all up and down it. And instead of tiny little tendrils, it's got like giant octopus tentacles sticking out the back of it, and it's floating around. And it immediately spots our heroes, because the big ones, the more advanced versions of these eyeball monsters, have true sight, so they can see through invisibility. And it screeches like a goddamn bald eagle and scares the pants off of both of them. And Alzack's like, we're gonna have to fight it. Light! And he activates a light spell like right in front of it to blind it and all the other eyeball creatures because it's complete darkness. And I was like, okay, roll initiative. And they're still invisible, still untraceable. So all the little ones are flying around trying to orient themselves and kind of see where these two invisible attackers are. But the big eyeball is the only one that can see them. And what does it do when it starts out on the combat round? It shoots an eyeball laser, because of course it does. And it hits Alzack square in the chest and tatters his robes all to hell. And he falls back and crashes into a crate. And of course, Phudo grabs him by the ankles and drags him away, because then, you know, the other 15 eyeballs immediately dash into the crate with their tiny little eyeball lasers, hoping to kill whatever it was. But, you know, he bled on the wood. So it's a good thing he's not traceable, because he would have been dripping blood everywhere. So, of course, Phudo grabs up the icy crossbow that he's got, and they start shooting back and forth at each other. Eyeball lasers and crossbow bolts and Snapcaster Dragon magic missiles are just flying back and forth. And the tiny little eyeball monsters are screeching and chirruping like little birds, like flying in all directions, trying to just run into them to see where they are, but they just can't manage to do it because Phudo can shoot a really far distance. And again, Snapcaster Dragon magic missiles don't miss unless you have a shield spell. So eventually they manage to take this nightmare thing out. And again, the little ones don't have true sight, so they book it immediately. Because as soon as they round the corner, the giant dinosaur with the pyramid head helmet comes out. And it spears the giant eyeball like right through the back. Of like where all of its tentacles are coming out and like starts to kind of consume it because it's already dead. It like slurps it up underneath the pyramid head style helmet. And Alzack, before they go, casts I think Innervate. Innervate basically covers everything in an area with like a pixie dust, so it serves as like a debuff in a number of ways for all the little eyeballs, so they won't chase them down or see where they're running into anything. And the dinosaur monster kind of grabs up one of the tiny eyeball monsters, and you hear like, and then it spits it out clean. And Alzack's like, we can't stay here, so he cancels the light spell, and Phudo grabs him basically by the hand and leads him far, far away, because that was a fucking disaster. Because as soon as a light source shows up in absolute darkness, oh, you're fucked. But Alzack couldn't fight blind, so that was a risk that they had to take. So they took off as quick as they could, and it's like, oh god, that was terrible. That was terrible. So they dash into like a little, I think it was like a bakery or a country store or something like that. it had a big front window that was mostly boarded up, and they dash inside and they close it and they grab the bell off the door because, you know, you open the door and it rings the bell. He grabs the bell and puts it in his bag because he's a kobold that might be useful later. And they sit in absolute silence for a while. They kind of lean and look out the cracks in the window to see if anything followed them. Thankfully, nothing. And I say, Phudo, you know, across the street, there's what looks like a governmental building. It has a domed ceiling and a spike at the very top. And there's a figure impaled on the spike all the way at the top. And Voodoo's like, what, really? And so he adjusts his eyes to the eagle, which gives him like a +5 to spot. And basically use them like binoculars. They're like the best item he's ever had. They're goggles. They're binoculars. They keep you from being dazzled. You know, we just kept adding shit to his eyes of the eagle because we could for convenience. But he adjusts his eyes of the eagles, the little dials on the side, to zoom all the way in. And it's a kobold. There is a kobold all the way up on the spire of this building. He's not decomposed. He's not a skeleton. He fell recently. And I say, Phudo, he's got like a little feathered headdress, and he's got like a painted stick on his side, and he's got a bag of supplies and like a little loincloth. And he looks kind of old. And Phudo kind of nods after a while. It's like, it's the wise man, you know, because they saw the shaman, who is the healer, all the way back with Stands with a Fist when they did that scrying ritual. The wise man was not accounted for. So he was swallowed up by the earth and was very, very unlucky in where he landed. I mean, if he'd hit the street, he'd have been paced, but he was very unlucky where he landed in the Lost District and was immediately impaled and died. But Phudo notices that he has his traveler's pack with him, which could in fact have food inside. And he looks at Alzack and he points, and Alzack can't see because they don't have a light. And he goes, stay here. I'm going to go across the street. And he goes, Phudo, no, don't run out into the open. And no, Phudo runs all the way across the street, and I roll it on fate. There's no patrols going by of flying eyeball monsters. So he makes it into the building, pushes the door open, and then like makes his way all the way up through the building out onto the roof. Okay, make me a climb check. He climbs all the way up onto the dome to examine the body of the old wise kobold. And it's like he's almost shorn in half. Like, he fell onto the spike and then came all the way, almost all the way down it. It would have ripped his body in half. But he's far down enough that you can reach him and examine him. It's like he reaches up and closes the poor guy's eyes. He can't exactly give him a burial down here. It's like, okay, you recover his pack and you find like a primitive healing kit and a like one potion and a couple of days rations. And he's like, yes, food. And he pockets all that, so he's feeling much better now that they've found more than, you know, 1 or 2 days worth of food. And that'll help them way, way longer in the long run. And, you know, he feels kind of bad that the poor guy got sucked into all this, but the entire region is roiling with, you know, these earthquakes and these elemental plane of water cracks and all this other garbage. So he was just a victim of circumstance, unfortunately. But he did get some food off of his pack. So Phudo, you know, climbs down, goes all the way back down to the building. No, don't run across the street. He runs across the street all the way back to Alzack, who is just sitting there in the dark because he doesn't dare light a light. And, you know, Phudo tells him everything he saw and shares some of the food with him, and they eat. And they decide to sit there and rest for a minute to kind of, like, get their bearings, take stock of themselves, maybe take a short rest, recover a little bit of health, a couple of spells, things like that. They're not going to linger down here for very long, but being inside a building is better than being out on the sidewalk, even when you're invisible. And I go, okay, your invisibility runs out. It's been X amount of time since you cast it. And so does Without a Trace, and so does your non-scrying stuff. So you made it pretty far being completely undetectable. It's like, well, I guess we could just reinstate those, but we're going to wait for now to recover what we can before we start casting magic again. So they eat, they kind of, like, mentally, so they don't make noise, discuss, you know, what you're going to run on the next move from here. Do we, you know, the smiling man is still out there, you know, do we, like, jack his spelljammer? Can we drive a spelljammer? Probably not. Phudo doesn't know how to sail a regular ship, and Alzack, you know, that's knowledge engineering, knowledge sailing, knowledge arcana, just a really weird amalgamation of things he probably doesn't have. Like, he has knowledge arcana, but it's not likely he's gonna know how to steer, you know, what basically amounts to a spaceship. So the spelljammer is still looking like the best way out of here, but they don't have any other leads, so they have to keep going, because the smiling man, you know, who knows what that ship is capable of. So while they're sitting there silently discussing with thought speak, they can hear voices coming up the street, and they go, oh God, what is it now? It's so crowded here. And who do they see coming up the street but Serpentara and her entourage? The albino lizard folk woman. She's got like a flat face and like a white culty garb. She was the one that kicked Alzac's ass and got away on the back of like a giant goldfish in the Forbidden Library all that time ago. She's walking up the middle of the street with like 15 guys. And the two guys in the back, of all things, are throwing bird seed. And they've got like a little group of little eyeball monsters following them around, who are like darting around and like chirruping and grabbing up the bird seed. Like, if you remember the monsters from Terraria, the little eyeball monsters, instead of like a pupil, they can have like teeth and grab things. It was kind of like that. So they would grab up the bird seed and not alert the giant dinosaur monster. So it was like a bribe almost as they were walking up the street. And Alzack and, you know, Fudo's describing all this to Alzack, and they've got lights. They've got, like, torches, so they can see where they're going. So Alzack can see them, too. And they're just flabbergasted. What the fuck are they doing down here? And, of course, they're not expecting anybody to be listening in or following them, so they're discussing their plans as they go down the street, you know. And the first words they hear out of Serpentara's mouth is, are the mana bombs ready? And Alzac's like, mana bombs? And mana bombs are exactly what they sound like. They're bombs that run off of arcane energy instead of, like, combustion or whatever. And they're just as potent. They're really expensive to make, but by God, do they work. Are the mana bombs ready? He says, and one of them goes, almost, mistress. They're putting the final finishing touches on them right now, and all the mapping works are almost complete. They go, you know, we're almost ready to drop another district of Oceanrim into the sea as planned. And they go, oh, shit, fuck. And Alzack kind of like leans and thinks at Phudo, you know, 700 years ago, this district sank into the sea because of some great calamity, and now they're back to do it again? Is that what's going on? You know, you set enough bombs in a row, you know, the city sits on a cliff. You could shear it off like somebody taking a bite out of a cookie, and it would just fall into the ocean water. They would just need to figure out exactly where to place the bombs to make it all fall. And just, oh my God, this is spiraling out of control really quickly. Like, Phudo is realizing that this is way beyond what's happening to the kobold. That the lizard folk are opening cracks to the elemental plane of water. They're gonna break off part of Oceanrim and send it into the sea, just like what happened 700 years ago, and earthquakes and all this other garbage. Like, this is going way beyond him, and he's starting to feel a little bit overwhelmed. And Serpentara speaks, they're still walking by. Serpentara says again, "Has there been any word on my twin sister?" And the lieutenant goes, "No, Serpentina is sticking to her own plans and sticking to shadows." You'd think she wouldn't be very hard to find, given that... And Serpentara kind of wheels on him and goes, "Given what? That she's albino? That she's a half-breed? That she's like me?" And she's kind of got him by the front of his... Like, she's half his size. But he's still kind of like... He's got sweat going down the side of his temple. He's like, "No, that's not what I meant, mistress. I'm very sorry. I didn't mean anything by it." So, of course, you don't mean anything by it. You don't have enough brain to mean anything. It's like, "You're lucky I need you on a daily basis, or I'd kill you where you stand." And she kind of, like, lifts her hand, her claws, up under, like, on the nape of his neck. And even from where they're sitting, Phudo and Alzack can see that she's got, like, purple-painted nails that are laced with poison, no doubt, because he's really nervous about the way she's kind of like scratching him under the chin, like the slightest prick would just make him foam at the mouth and die. Okay, and it goes, "You know, the Padclaw tribe of Kobold have been basically annihilated. You know, Oceanrim is on high alert. We will have to move our plans forward much more quickly than we initially thought. So I want those bombs ready within the week." And, you know, Phudo and Alzack kind of look at each other, just sitting in this window listening to this exposition, but, you know, whatever. But it's at that point that they kind of get it into their heads that, you know, Serpentara is the leader of this. Serpentina, they've never met, but Serpentara is clearly, like, the culty leader here. They gotta take her out. And there's 15 guys out there with her, so now is not the time. But clearly they're using the Lost District as like a base of operations or something. So if they can placate the eyeball monsters and avoid the giant flying tentacle monster, the flying polyp, sorry, if they can avoid the giant polyp and placate the little eyeball monsters, they might have, like, a house or a base or something or a castle down here, because it's been here for 700 years. If they're getting in and out by some secret way and nobody else knows this district is down here, it makes for the perfect hiding spot right under Oceanrim, where all their evil machinations are going anyway. Phudo can't quite figure out why the lizard folk wanted all those staffs, though, because if they just want to destroy the city and send it into the sea, why rip open all those portals just to make it worse? It doesn't make a lot of sense, but clearly they don't have the whole picture yet. But they kind of get it in their heads, they need to follow these people. They need to kind of get Serpentara out of the picture as soon as possible. Like, she might have lieutenants, but clearly she's the head of the proverbial snake. So they decide to follow these guys, like, just down the center of the street. They've got torches and stuff, so they're not hard to follow. You know, Alzack makes them invisible, and Phudo puts Pass Without a Trace on them again, and he makes them unscryable again, so nothing can spot them except for the giant eyeballs that have true sight, but they didn't see any more of those, thankfully. And Alzack is like, "Phudo, you know, you're a rangerly sort. Can you track them? You know, we got to stay really far back. Can you track them so we can follow them to wherever they're going?" And Fudo's like, "I don't know. It's solid, you know, following somebody over solid stone. They don't exactly leave a trail." And then he looks down and he kind of lifts his foot and looks at the bottom of his foot, which is covered with bird seed. And he's like, "Oh, wait, no, never mind. They're leaving a trail of birdseed everywhere they go to placate the little eyeball monsters. So you don't even need to make a roll for this. You just follow the breadcrumbs, or you follow the birdseed, and stay at a safe distance, and you'll follow them wherever they go." And sure enough, they go to what looks like used to be like a duke's house. It's a big mansion with like a stone wall surrounding it. The gate is gone, because why would you need a gate down here? But Serpentara leads this like entourage of guys into this mansion area, and almost all the windows are lit up with like candles or other forms of light. So there's a bunch of dudes in there just kind of hanging out. Like, this is the base of operations for the lizard folk that that stole the book, that grabbed all the staffs, that killed Eldon Shortwick, who almost killed Alzack, who tangled with Mattias the Prowler. This is where they all hang out. This is it. And Fudo's like, all right, well, you know, he used to be a bounty hunter slash assassin slash other things in Oceanrim. So he decides the best thing to do, because Serpentara is no doubt a powerful spellcaster, plus the book that she stole from the Forbidden Library, you know, the maintenance and destruction of wide range portals. You know, she's probably like a 9th level spellcaster. So, Fudo decides that they need to like get a vantage point. Like, he wants to be up on a roof somewhere, like a sniper. And Alzack agrees, you know, this is a great idea. So they trek through darkness, Fudo kind of leading him by the sleeve to like the building next door, which is also a big house. So they get up onto the 3rd floor and like out onto the flat of the roof, and they discover that they start looking at windows, and they discover that Serpentara is still outside. She's like wandering around in the courtyard, kind of like mumbling to herself and like no doubt thinking about her plans and her plots for Oceanrim above. And a couple of the eyeball monsters kind of fly around her, grabbing up birdseed as they go. It's like she's kind of like a really evil Disney princess. She's just kind of walking around humming and like tapping her fingers on her chin, thinking to herself, all the other guys went inside. There's no telling how many of them there are, so if you're gonna jump her, you know, now is probably the time. And even then, you're not gonna get much more than 2 or 3 rounds before they all boil out into the courtyard and kick your ass. So what are you guys gonna do? Because, you know, if you shoot her in the back and she turns around and shoots like a 10d6 lightning bolt up your nose, it's still gonna suck to be you. So what are you gonna do? Fudo decides he's gonna use one of his death arrows, the +8 to attack, +8 to damage things. He got a couple from his father for his birthday, if you remember. And he loads it up, and, you know, bolts and arrows we just used interchangeably, because it's no fun to not have a longbow and have a death arrow. So he loads up the death arrow, you know, plus his icy crossbow is like a +2 weapon, plus he's got all these different bonuses for being a ranger, for using a crossbow specialization, for it being this amount of feet away, etc., etc. And he loads up all these bonuses into this one shot, and I was like, Fudo, you grab like a gun sight and you screw it on, and you lay down on your belly and you cock one leg like a military sniper, and Alzac's just kind of laying next to him, like watching him like put together the rifle before the shot. And I was like, Fudo, you know, there's no distractions here, and she's not like darting around or anything, and there's nobody rushing you, so I'm just gonna give you the 20 for this. You can just take 20, and I don't really give 20s very often, but he really did have all the time in the world to take his time and make the shot count. So that was an automatic, like, critical success for him, because the circumstances could not have been much better. And that, and she's just wearing, like, a culty robe, so it's not like she had any armor to push away a serrated black death arrow. And he's like, all right, so I line up the shot, and I lay down, and I cock one leg, and I've got my crossbow ready. And I load up the gun sight, and I load up the death arrow, and, you know, he rolls the dice, you know, 20, because we gave him the 20, and he shoots Serpentara in the back, and the point of the arrow explodes out between her breasts, and she's just like, "Hoo!" And she falls to her knees, like her hands on either side of her, she's sitting on her legs. And then she kind of falls to one side, and a big pool of blood kind of grows around her. And Alzack kind of leans up, and Phudo looks up outside of like the gun sight that's not actually there, but it is. He like looks, he's like, did you get her? Was that it? And of course, Phudo believes in double tapping, so he loads up another arrow. He like slams the cartridge in, and he takes aim and he shoots her in the back again. She doesn't move. She just like the back of her robe starts to turn pink, and like the little the hood on the back of her cloak reveals that, you know, she had like a head of hair, unlike the rest of her. So she was a half breed, probably elven or something like that, to give her great longevity and like a flat face, like a human being. That she was just an albino, very strange character. She had a lot of really weird templates all up and down her. But Phudo one-shots her with a death arrow, and she falls dead because she's got no protection, no nothing. And he rolled like maximum damage, so double maximum damage on like this perfect shot, doing, you know, 8 times 2 extra damage, so plus 16. He one-shotted this woman, and she died in the courtyard without a sound. So none of her minions know she's dead. None of her lieutenants, nobody. She stayed out in the courtyard, confident that their base was hidden and nobody was around. But this was the one day where there was somebody around. So Serpentara was slain by a sniper shot from Phudo the Bullet Slayer and his +2 crossbow bolt and his +8 death arrow. So she died, and they look at each other. They're kind of confused. Like, they were kind of expecting her to go, ouch, and then whirl around and shoot the 10d6 fireball up their noses. But she didn't. She just died. And they're like, what do we do now? We should get out of here before somebody comes outside to check on her. So they turn around and they book it out into the street, and then again making their way towards the docks. But as soon as they turn around, the smiling man is there on the roof with them. And they're like, ugh, can he see us? And I was like, yeah, he can. He has true sight. And they're like, oh, what do you want? What do you want? We're kind of busy. They look over their shoulders. They see this puddle of blood is growing bigger and bigger. The first guy that glances out a window is going to raise the alarm because she was wearing all white. She was albino, and she's sitting in this giant red pool of blood. He's like, what do you want? We're kind of busy. We got to get out of here. And he goes, yeah, good job. You killed my wife. And he's like, that was your wife? And the conversation kind of wheels around for a while that Serpentara was probably not actually his wife because he's kind of crazy, but she was a beautiful female figure he saw on a daily basis, so he kind of wished that she was his wife, and eventually that wish kind of came true in his mind, even if he never went and talked to her. So Serpentara was the target to get the spelljammer moving. It's like, well, it's time to go. Let's go. So they follow him out into the street and towards the docks, far and away, and they don't hear the alarm go off. They don't hear anything. So they got away pretty darn scot-free, having killed the leader of the cult that has been finding all these staffs and killing all these people and kidnapping all these children and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. She's dead, and they're leaving, and they didn't get caught. So this is like the best day ever for them. And finally, the smiling man, freakish freaking thing that he is. Again, think like Slender Man, but like with a face and a top hat, and like his lips are like stapled, like metal staples up onto his cheekbones. So he's always grinning as wide as he possibly can. And, you know, his eyes are rolled up into his skull, so you can only see the white. He's a nightmarish creature. And he's like, well, time to go. Get on the ship. Nah! And he like, pulls the gangplank for them with, like, a lever and, like, strides up like he owns the place, because he does. And he leads them inside the spelljammer. And the spelljammer, it's like a spaceship or a submarine or something. It's a boat made of metal that can go through sand or earth or water or whatever it wants. It can become incorporeal. It can fly in outer space. It's a magic boat. It does whatever the hell it wants. And he goes, you know, welcome to the Beholder. And Alzack goes, why is it called the Beholder? And he goes, because when you say it really fast, it sounds like beehole. And Alzack and Phudo kind of look at each other like, this guy's fucking insane. We have to get to the surface and then run. And he's like, but a deal's a deal. Are we ready? And Alzack kind of looks out the porthole window and goes, you know, we can't leave, though. We killed Serpentara, but the whole cult is right there. And they've still got those mana bombs. You know, no doubt she had, like, a last will and testament or a number of lieutenants that were, you know, if I die, if I get shot in the back by some asshole kobold. God, that was so funny. But if I die, you know, here are my instructions to destroy another district of Oceanrim and drop it into the sea. And they're like, gosh, were they just going to open a giant portal and, like, sacrifice a district of Oceanrim to the elemental plane of water or to Cthulhu? Like, Cthulhu needs a sacrifice every 700 years, so they open a giant portal and drop a portion of the city in there, so tens of thousands of people get sacrificed to this giant squid monster. And, like, they're trying to piece it together. They don't have all the pieces yet. They're trying to figure out why. Why Oceanrim? Why on such a grand scale? Why do they need so many of these staffs to open a portal? Why do they want a portal that big? Why do they want so many people dead? Why? They don't have all the why, but unfortunately Serpentara's dead, so they're not going to get the why. And the smiling man kind of like flips one of the levers and the beholder starts to like hover up into the air. They're like 20, 30, 40 feet up. And he goes, well, we could just destroy them if you want. I mean, the beehole. The beehole. The beehole has many weapons. And he's just like, he's probably spent a lot of time thinking about these jokes. The beehole has lots of weapons. But he's got like a big dial to one side that is for the ship's cannon. And the cannon has labels on it like unravel, incinerate, cockatrice, all these other things. And Alzack kind of thinks for a while and he rolls the knowledge arcana and he realizes that the beholder cannon emulates all of the eyeball lasers of like a beholder, because the beholders have like 8 or 10 eye stalks and all of them do something horrible different that usually kills you instantly. The cannon can do all of those things. So you could shoot it off and turn somebody to stone. You could shoot it off and turn somebody to ash. You could shoot it off and unravel something entirely from existence and things like that. It's like, it does all those things. The beholder can just destroy things like that. And he's like, yeah, did you want to do that before we leave? I am on a schedule. And he looks at his wrist. He doesn't have a watch. or a pocket watch or anything. He kind of lifts up his wrist like, it's a freckle past 4. I got places to be. And they're like, all right. Well, why don't we incinerate the place? Just turn the whole place to ash. You know, God knows what those mana bombs are going to do when we burn them up. But it better to destroy them and everybody in there and, you know, risk a cave-in or whatever it happens to be than to leave them there and let them plant them and shear off a piece of Oceanrim into the sea again. A second calamity could destroy the city if they do it even slightly wrong. And if they do it even slightly right, that's tens of thousands of people that are going to die. We can't leave with those intact. So, you know, yes, smiling man, you know, incinerate that Duke's mansion and everybody in it. And he's like, all right. And he bangs the big red button and the front of the ship splays open. And, you know, the giant, like, phallic symbol comes out, the giant cannon. And it's like that scene out of Skies of Arcadia, if you've played that RPG. You know, Moonstone Cannon, fire! It's, you know, Beholder Cannon, fire! And the smiling man's like, Behole, fire! and he shoots the incineration ray, and the entire mansion falls into dust. It doesn't explode, it doesn't burst into flames, it just collapses. You know, like in a cartoon, when you see something like go up in flames so fast that it leaves like matchsticks behind? It's like that, but there was nobody left, no mana bombs, no furniture, no nothing. Everybody inside died and was reduced to dust, and then the frame just kind of fell apart and just like ash rose into the air. He's like, okay, it's done. And Alzack and Phudo are looking at each other like, wow, this was really easy. I'm not complaining, but holy crap, we took care of a lot of stuff today. And they kind of, Alzack kind of reaches all the way down, like past his waist level, and Phudo gives him like a quiet little high five. And the smiling man withdraws the cannon and closes the ship up and starts pulling levers and knobs and dials. And of course, Alzack starts taking notes on all the shit around him because it's a spelljammer. You know, they don't make those anymore. They're basically legendary weapons or legendary vehicles, rather. Nobody knows how to make a spelljammer anymore. And this freakish guy has one. He's got to take notes on everything while he's still here. And so they start rising up through the cavern because, of course, it's a spelljammer. It can fly. They start rising up through the cavern. They can see the little groups of eyeball monsters flying around, and they see the dinosaur creature leap from a rooftop to grab something else, no doubt like another rat or something. And I was like, you can see the little speck of red where Serpentara lays splayed out in the courtyard where you shot her in the back twice. And Phudo's not even sorry. Alzack's not sorry. You know, they cut the head off the snake and then they blew up their house. You know, that's about as complete a victory as you can possibly get. And the smiling man takes them all the way back to the surface to the docking area, the current docking area of Oceanrim, and he extends the gangplank and they get off and he's like, well, nice seeing you. And he pulls the gangplank back in, and he goes back into his ship. And the ship kind of stays there, but Phudo suddenly realizes he's out in broad daylight. So he quick pulls his cloak up, pulls his little hood up, and he pulls his tail up under his cloak. And Alzack's like, don't worry, you know, we can run to my place and run the next move from there. You know, and by then they're really tired, because they've been awake for a very long time, fighting and blowing shit up and hiding and stuff like that. And Phudo's like, no, I have to get back to the kobold burrow and, you know, make sure they know I'm not dead and things like that. I have to get out of Oceanrim and get back to the Thirsty River Rock. So they take off, like, down alleyways and stuff. Anybody that doesn't take a really close look at him isn't going to see that he's a kobold. So they sneak out and they get into the Oceanrim waterways, which Phudo knows really, really well because he used to run assassination missions, like in his backstory. So he knows the waterways really, really well, and he can get out like on the western side of the city. And they make it scot-free out into the woods and along the road. It's only then that they realize that they left the smiling man at the dock just to talk to random citizens and things like that. They never saw him again. But I thought it was really funny that they just kind of left him there with that really powerful spelljammer, just kind of parked there, you know, and he kind of served his purpose for the story. So we just said that he headed back down into the Lost District because that was kind of where he lived. But, they left him there at the dock to just kind of do whatever the fuck he wanted. So that was a loose end for them that they did not think about until much later. So then came the hard 8-hour trek, and it was not an easy one because Phudo and Alzack have been awake for like almost 24 hours solid, running, hiding, fighting, shooting people, getting on to spelljammers, etc., etc. They've been awake for a very long time, so they eat some more food. You know, they don't stop for anything. They go westward, inland, to the Thirsty River Rock, which is again like an 8-hour journey. Even like moving double time to try and get just across the landscape. And anytime, you know, they you know, get off the road, Phudo, somebody's coming, you know, every time they had to do that, etc., etc. But they make it all the way there, and Phudo leads him into the hidden entrance of the new Padclaw burrow. And they are set upon by what few guards they have. And he goes, "Cobard, don't worry. It is I, Phudo Padclaw. Cobard." And Alzack kind of stands there while they talk in Koboldese, which sounds like a Pokemon. You know, "Cobard, Cobard, Cobard, Cobard." And they point up at Alzack, and he's like, "Cobard, Cobard, 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 Cobard. Cobard, 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 Cobard." And this just kind of goes back and forth. So they finally, they let Alzack in as well, because he is a friend, and he has fought by Fudo's side, etc., etc. And they have to go in, they have to find Stands with a Fist, and the shaman, the healer, and etc., etc. So it is finally revealed that Phudo the Bullet Slayer survived the Great Earthquake, and that the wise man was taken as he fell into the earth and was impaled, and isn't that sad? And, you know, look at how many kobold are missing, but look at how many kobold are here. They look around and like we took a head count. There's like 117 of us. He's like, "Wow, that's actually really good." You know, over 100 kobold survived, and they're still like they're coming back in like twos and threes every couple of days. So there could be even more out there, but they've got over 100 survivors. That's great. You know, all the kobold that were up in like the upper chambers of the old burrow that didn't immediately get flooded with icy cold salt water with no way to get out. So they're very pleased that Phudo is back. They haven't heard from any of his siblings, and of course Stands with a Fist has to take Phudo aside to speak about his father. And she goes, "You know, Phudo, he was an old man. He was using up the Staff of Lightning. You know, we brought him all the way back here, but he never woke up." So the chieftain of the Padclaw tribe is dead, and until any of Phudo's siblings show up, if they show up, and there's 15 of them, so there's good chances, until any of them show up, Phudo and the shaman and Stands with a Fist are basically in charge of the Padclaw tribe now. And they're like refugees. They're curled up in corners in like twos and threes, piled this way and that, like so many sad puppies, while they're trying to dig out new tunnels, new living areas, so that they're kind of crammed in there right now. They're digging out new living areas, new barracks, new nesting areas, etc., etc. This is basically like a camp right now, and there's way too many kobold here. And, you know, they're fishing like crazy, they're hunting like crazy, they're trying to feed everybody, and, you know, there's not enough blankets, there's not enough fuel, etc., etc. So they're at a point of desperation right now, but they are happy that so many of them survived such a great calamity. So now they are closing ranks about each other to support one another, because in kobold society, you are only as strong as the kobold that stands next to you. And Alzack is kind of like standing back in the background with all these little lizard people running around him. Like Little Miss goes up to him. He's like, "Wow, he's really tall." And she comes up to his knee, so she's really tiny. And he like looks down and he's like tries to pat her on the head, but she runs away like a cat. And finally, Phudo sets aside, you know, give this tall two legs food and give him hot water and give him a place, you know, that's his size that he can sleep. And we will reconvene on the morn, so they can explain to the shaman and with Stands of the Fist everything that has happened, because it looks like things are turning up now that Serpentara is dead and the cult and all their mana bombs have been destroyed. But that doesn't fix all of the giant cracks that are everywhere, much less the earthquakes, much less the fact that Oceanrim has basically covered the region with paladins and other knights and would-be adventurers. They're going to look for more of these cracks, so they're in hiding, and there's 1/7 of them left. And, you know, the cult of Serpentara might be quelled, But if there's any more out there, it's going to be trouble. If there's anything else going on, it's going to be trouble, because those cracks are appearing by themselves. So those staffs are clearly meant to, like, make them wider, to stabilize them, to cause more trouble. If they were going to drop a portion of Oceanrim into the sea, there might already be cracks, like, out in the bay area that are just waiting to, like, connect into, like, a big circle to, like, suck the water down and then blow off a part of the city and drop it into the sea. It's gonna suck to be them. Despite their massive victory, there's a lot of cleanup to do. But for the moment, they've got to kind of sit, relax, breathe. You know, yes, stands with a fist, I am alive. Yes, let us go make love in one side area, stuff like that. Plus, Phudo still has the Queen in White, the forbidden grimoire that he cannot read, because when he reads it, he immediately forgets what's in it. So he needs to show that to Alzack. So there's still a bunch of stuff that needs to be done, but it was a great victory to take out Serpentara and the cult. So that is where we will stop for today, and I hope you enjoyed that story, and I will see you guys on the next D&D Stories. Keep gaming.
Hi guys, T here. Remember to hit that like button for me on your way out. If you'd like to see artwork and maps from my gaming table, check out the D&D Stories Facebook page. Also, I have a Patreon if you'd like to toss a few gold pieces into your humble bard's hat. Links in the description below. Keep gaming!